my honor to welcome and interview Dr. R.G. D'Souza, Principal Annapurna Institute of Technology, on behalf of College Duniya. The strong academic credentials include Doctorate in Civil Engineering from NITK and M.Tech in Structural Engineering and B.E. in Civil Engineering from MIT Manipal. He has published a few national and international papers in journals and conferences and guides research scholars. He is also a life member of professional bodies like Indian Concrete Institute, Association of Consulting Civil Engineers, India and Indian Society for Technical Education, Fellow of the Institution of Engineers and Institution of Valuers India. Welcome to College Duniya, sir. So you have held key position at educational institutes throughout your professional career. What are the key factors that keep you connected with the education sector?
Good morning, madam, and thanks to College Duniya for giving me this opportunity to speak out my thoughts. Coming to your first question on how I relate to or how I have kept myself connected with the education sector. By training, I am a civil engineer, and civil engineering more so is concerned with the societal concerns, more so about improving people's lives. And I think that the physical traits that I have or the personal traits that I have which has given me a strong leadership skill with vision, passion, integrity, dedication, and as a strong communicator, I thought I could influence and have the power to sway, the power to affect somebody's life. And I believe that as a leader, as an educational leader, I can transform an institute, and through an institute, student lives, and through them, a community as a whole. So these are the things which kept me grounded to the education sector. Go ahead, madam.
Great, sir. So being the principal of Annapurna Institute of Technology, what is your philosophy of leadership and how would you describe your leadership style?
Basically, madam, I don't think so that we can stick on to a single leadership style in education. Given the experience of my years of taking up different roles in an educational institution, and also due to my mentoring through various heads of the institutions where I started my career, I just blended the various leadership styles. It might be instructional leadership, it might be transformational leadership, constructivist leadership, the servant leadership, and the strategic leadership. Basically, I am more so bothered about the transformational leadership and the servant leadership, where in transformational leadership, I'm able to affect the outcome of the students' attributes or the learning styles, wherein they become capable of leading a comfortable life in the society. And also, wherein I lead by example. The servant leadership is all about leading by example, wherein I have to shun out my ego and I have to be an exemplary leader. So I have just blended these five or six leadership styles, and I have been successful in delivering whatever I have envisioned to my educational institution. That is what I would like to say, because there is no single leadership style which would be successful in education.
Well said, sir. Actually, I also believe the same. So, being the principal of Annapurna Institute of Technology, how do you strategize about the key programs and plans for the marketing and administration of your college?
If you talk about the marketing plans or the advertising or the programs that we hold, we believe, or rather along with my management, I believe that marketing should be through word of mouth and not through ads or not through hoardings or not through any other digital media. And I believe that students and alumni of our institution are our brand ambassadors. And this brings to what is a student ambassador or what is an alumni ambassador? He or she should be, as an alumni or a student, should be exactly like a peer to the students, wherein we'd be offering higher education, and his experiences and his ways in which his or her ways in which they have dealt with the challenges in their future life or in their career should be a marketing tool for our institution. So we believe in the strategy that students or the alumni are our brand ambassadors, and it has worked well beyond the traditional marketing that most of the institutions follow. These do serve in getting good admissions, good placements, and also better visibility for the institution.
Good, sir. So the education system in India and other foreign countries are structured very differently. So in your experience, what can an inbound students gain from studying here in your Inapoya Institute of Technology?
This is the latest trend. Most of the institutions are categorized as tier 1, tier 2 and tier 3. But holistically speaking, an institution should have a proper or a higher performance education system. The strategy should be towards dealing with the customer base, that is the stakeholders. The current scenario is we are offering our services to a world market, a global market, wherein the stakeholders remain the same. There might be demographic differences or geographical differences, or sometimes on student attributes. But ultimately, we have to see that that we deal with, or rather, give a high performance environment for education, or the education system should be a high performing one. At Inapoya Institute of Technology, we have taken care that we pay attention to these 10 points. One is, we should set high academic and content standards. We deliver curriculum and coursework efficiently through ICT tools. Maintain high transparency and student assessments, which is the need of the hour. Maintain high clarity in the expectations and evaluations of both students and faculty. Facilitate high placement so that applicants can choose the college optimally. Meaning to say, it is not that you get the highest paying job, which I will elaborate in my later during my answers. And provide core support and essential autonomies for students and faculty members. Ensure personal development through ongoing training. Provide performance measures well in advance to all students, faculty members and heads of the department. So it is ultimately holistically dealt so that nobody is disconnected. The students, the faculty and the society at large are meeting each other's expectations. Address underperformance by providing evaluation-based supports and also align positive incentives and negative consequences to induce all key persons, all stakeholders, either if we follow the management principle of rewarding the good things and also having negative consequences for the people missing out. So this is the crux of the whole study program at Inapoya Institute of Technology.
Great, sir. So how does the curriculum of Inapoya Institute of Technology ensures the best practice of industry?
Currently, since we are affiliated to the university and we are an affiliated college, we do not have much to do with the tweaking with the syllabus per se or the curriculum which is to be offered for engineering education in this part of the country. But focus, we can always think about two things. One is the changing engineering student demographics. And the second one is the changing engineering student attributes. For most of the 20th century students entering engineering school, they used to normally come from high strata of the society, and their caliber or the capability or the studying ability or the absorbing capacity was very high. But more recently, engineering colleges have been admitting a much broader cross-section of students' population, and we have to deal with the students who have to overcome their deficiencies in their pre-college program. So this is a positive development, but it means that ineffective teaching. So we have to see that whatever curriculum is delivered in an effective manner. So this is one point which we practice, effective delivery of curriculum, and then the changing engineering student attributes. Today, we are all talking about millennials and the current trend of the students post the pandemic or during this unprecedented times is that we have moved into a digital platform, and students' capacity to concentrate or the length at which student can concentrate has reduced, and everything is available on a super information superhighway. So the old instructional methods that work for us as teachers may not be working, but the assumption that it might be bad when applied to millennials and it is not going to work, we have to change with the times. So we have to change our curriculum, or rather we have paid attention on changing the delivery of the curriculum, the system in which the curriculum is delivered to the changing student attributes. So these are the two things which we can say that we are the best practices in the industry that we are following. One is catering to the changing student demographics, and second is catering to the changing engineering student attributes.
Agree with you, sir. So any insights into how your university could be more welcoming to students of different races or economic background?
Basically speaking, it has been the philosophy of our institution and also our group, which runs enough educational institutions in this area, right from medical, dental, nursing to engineering and also paramedical courses and also schools and colleges. Our belief continues in diversity and inclusiveness. And also we have systems wherein we award scholarships, we have adoption schemes for the economically backward, and also we never think about the gender inequality, whichever may be the branch of engineering, whichever may be the study area that they are going to take. So these four pillars, one is belief in diversity and inclusiveness, the scholarship award system, the adoption scheme for the economically poor, and supporting the gender equality movement. These are the four pillars which make us welcome to the different races or economic backgrounds.
In that case, what do you think your roles and responsibilities to the university and the students are?
We have to cater to a group of students wherein the capabilities are different, the abilities are different, they come from different backgrounds. I think so the balancing act of delivering the same content, the content which is making them competent enough to face the world, is a major challenge. And this is where, as an educational administrator, I have to get in my five different leadership skills, wherein it should be a win-win situation for all the stakeholders.
Correct, sir. So what do you think should be the university's top priority over the next 10 years?
I think right now, since we are an educational institution, the only priority would be skilling the workforce of the future. For this, we have to strategize. We have to change our ways in which, or the programs which we are offering, or maybe the tweak a little on add-on courses, because we can't do much about the syllabus since we are an affiliated college. But I think our long-term plan is to develop ourselves into a standalone institution and maybe an university which is having autonomous perspectives. So I think the priority right now is to skill the students, who will be the workforce for the future.
Great. So when you first came to Annapoya Institute of Technology, what was your vision for the university, and has it evolved over time, and how far along in implementing that vision are you?
As an educational administrator, my vision should match with the mission or the vision statement of the institute. So when I came in, I saw that I have entered into the portals of a institution where imparting quality education at par with international standards was the outlook. But I thought, let me break down into small, achievable, measurable goals. And then I broke it down to these five points or five milestones. One is to shape a vision of academic success for all students. Nobody should be left out. Second was creating a climate hospitable to engineering education. Engineering education should not be by chance, but it should be by choice. Second was cultivating a leadership skill in all those people who matter. Maybe the support staff, maybe the administrative staff, maybe the faculty involved, and managing people, data and processes effectively so that we got credibility. Whichever year a student is studying, what would be his baseline, or what would be his, the trends that he is having, or the traits that he is having, which means we could nurture and we could train them to become better engineers. Then improving the institute's visibility by giving a strong leadership and a strong team. So these are the core things which I concentrated on, And as far as my knowledge goes, and as far as the achievements that we have done in the past 4 or 5 years, we have achieved considerable lot.
Great, sir. So what would you like people to know about your college they may not know?
When you talk about engineering colleges in India, and more so in South India, which is a hub for education, and more so about Mangalore, which is supposed to be the birthplace of banks and educational institutions, I would like to say to people around that don't look at our college as another engineering college, but as an institute which identifies interests, nurtures passion, and creates leader of future, both in act and creed. This is a single sentence that I would like to put in a nutshell, what people can expect from our institute.
Wow, that's a wonderful message, sir. So what do you see as Principal Annapoya Institute of Technology's greatest strength?
True to our vision and mission, and to my personal vision about the institution, I had identified the strengths and weaknesses, and we tried our level best to smooth out the weaknesses so that they don't become a threat. But strongly speaking, a strong curriculum delivery system and evaluation, teamwork of our faculty and staff, quality assured teaching learning system aimed at holistic development of an YITian, strength of character, that is steadiness in midst of difficulties, the pandemic, the past 8 to 10 months, the commitment or the positive morale or the commitment that has been shown by our faculty and students, even today, the students, the way in which they are concentrating has shown, or the way in which they are participating in both offline and online modes of education that we are imparting has shown that we have seen this as a great strength. The connectivity, close relationship between student and academic affairs professionals at our institute, willingness to recognize weakness and make improvements by the management. So the management also plays an important role. The administration and the management should recognize the weakness and make improvements. That is when we can achieve and produce knowledgeable graduates from rural areas, because the college, which is situated in the outskirts of Mangalore, Mangalore being a tier 2 city, which is steadily growing towards being the next Silicon Valley, or maybe the next tier 1 city in the coming days, foreseeable future, the students, faculty are committed to the college and community. So location in an area of natural beauty, because I would like to invite all of those who would be watching this or here listening to me, that this environment in which this college is situated is very, very conducive for learning, and it has been appreciated by one and all.
Sure, sir. We would like to come and visit the university and have the facility of viewing all your structures and natures and everything. So what are some of the biggest challenges you see both for higher education in general and for Annapoya Institute of Technology specifically?
I have just identified a few in the past course of years that have taken up the helm of affairs at this institute. What has happened is, it's the general trend pan-India, which engineering colleges are facing, and not per se with the Annapoya Institute of Technology in specific, but ordinary campuses are not preferred by recruiters. So the placement happens only at the tier 1 colleges and tier 1 cities. I think this is a great challenge, and the colleges have to pay a lot of attention in giving a lot of visibility and telling people, or rather making it imperative, that institutions in tier 2 cities also churn out engineers who are ready to take up any challenges. The second thing is there is a lack of training. The lack of training is not because of lack of facilities, but the international content, the internet material, the global material which can create awareness about international practices and standards is missing, because we are only participating in within the country, and there is no transfer of knowledge which is globally in vogue or in practice. It might be in electronics, it can be in mechanical, or it can be in any of the fields. Normally what happens is, an engineering graduate from India, when he leaves the country, when he goes to other countries or to international areas to work, he will feel the difference. The second thing is expert class faculty and world class resources. We are just giving what is available. We are not networking. So networking with the international colleges, or colleges abroad or colleges which have become centers of excellence, I think that is more important. And syllabus has to be updated as per the industry standards. And a university cannot do much because it has to cater to a large group of students. So I think the new education policy which has come up, which says that colleges should become standalone universities, will go a long way in breaking this or meeting this challenge. And lastly, students these days do not, there are a lot of hackathons and ideathons happening, but I think so the lack of live projects wherein the college students are involved should increase. And these are the challenges, these are the four or five challenges which I've identified, and Enapo Institute of Technology has been working on this challenge so that we improve the student experience and they become well equipped to face the challenges globally.
So any suggestion you would like to give to the current youth and the aspiring students?
I did begin my career as a student welfare officer in my previous institution wherever I started my career. Then I went on to become a student, a training placement coordinator. So as I rose to the level of the principal, I have been continuously telling students only one sentence: choose your profession, not a job. And engineering is a profession. A job is a role of a person in a society, and profession is a vocation founded upon specialized educational training. And engineering is one such profession. One occupation means it's a regular activity performed by a person to earn his bread and butter. Whereas a profession is an occupation or vocation which requires high degree of knowledge and expertise in specific field. There is no code of conduct in an occupation. There is not a requirement of training, not regulated by statute. And the basis of pay or the remuneration is based on what you produce or what you manufacture. Whereas for a profession, it is based on skill and knowledge. Formal education is enough for an occupation, or a skill education is enough. Professional education is required for a profession. And the degree of independence is, there is no degree of independence in an occupation. You have to stereotype the job is what you are looking into. Whereas a profession is a completely independent one, and the responsibilities are more, and the state as well. The respect and status also is more. So what has to be happening is the student who comes out from engineering college who has to look out for a profession. And this is my suggestion to the current youth who are taking up engineering profession or any profession for that matter. Don't look for a job, look for a profession, let it be your vocation.
Correct, sir. 100% agree with you, sir. So what are some plans that you are currently or will be designing for Enapoya Institute of Technology's international affairs or for students?
We are trying our level best to attract international students, more so foreign students. We have been successful in attracting non-resident Indians or PIOs, that is people of Indian origin, but we are trying to attract foreign nationals too. And our strategic approaches for this is enhancing the country's image. So this has already been a destination. India has already been a destination for foreign nationals and also for foreign students for their studies. It has been a tourist attraction. Medical tourism is picking up like anything. And I think the next would be the educational sector, wherein we'll be opening up for international students, given our reasonable fee structure and the student experiences. So we are trying to bridge the information gaps, that is, what is available, remuneration or what honorarium these things are available. And we are trying our level best to understand the international student segments, because different countries have different prime areas wherein the educational sector is concentrating on. We are trying to identify that. And then we are investing in international student experience, because most of the cases, most of the colleges, irrespective of the discipline, they will be only canvassing or advertising on what it can be offered to students through websites or through digital media. But on the ground, there should be a lot of investing which should happen to make the student experience one which is going to go a long way in getting more students, giving them a better experience, and giving them an international skilled professional experience. So this is what we are trying to, and these are the four strategic approaches which we are taking up in the coming years, which I hope would be helpful in achieving foreign student admissions.
Sure. So how do you tend to establish a healthy relation and environment in your institute or university?
As I have clearly earmarked, pointed out right in the beginning, I think if all the stakeholders know their responsibility and their responsibilities are properly within a framework, so that there is a complementary action by all the stakeholders, be it the peers at home, be it the peers from the industry, be it the peers in college, or the faculty members and the management. If everything goes hand in hand, this relationship can be so much so that I can always say it should mimic a symbiotic relationship. Everywhere there should be a give and take, wherein the experience would then tend to be a win-win situation.
Great, sir. So yeah, we came up to the last questions and we are completed too. So thanks for your time and insightful thoughts on education, sir. So it gave us a broad picture about what students can expect from the college and the course. Also, what is expected from the students to join Inapoya Institute of Technology. So wishing you have a great year ahead, sir. Thanks a lot for joining College Dunia's interview session.
Thank you, madam, for taking up this session, and also thanks to College Dunia. Hope to have more interactions and also a fruitful journey ahead. All the best to you, madam.
Thank you, sir.